In the next part, we are looking at stability conditions, and we will use the virial theorem in order to help us to understand qualitatively under what conditions a cloud of gas will be either stable against gravitational contraction and under what conditions it will not be stable. So, writing down the virial theorem again, here we have terms that are opposing the collapse, which is this term and the B. Kinetic energy is basically working in driving the particles apart. The magnetic pressure counters any compression of the magnetic field lines. So these are forces that oppose collapse, and we have terms that favor collapse, which is the surface pressure term, naturally, which creates an inward force. And we have the self-gravity here that is also pulling our system towards the center of mass. Of course, the surface term can be positive or negative, depending on whether we have material flowing in or flowing out. But that's just as a side remark. Now we will use the previous considerations to look at thermal support and the so-called Jeans instability criterion. Let's quickly estimate the Jeans instability. Consider that gas pressure always tries to smooth out the gas. This is working against a collapse. So that's also in agreement with our intuition, namely that pressure is increasing if something tries to collapse and working against further collapse. Self-gravity, on the other hand, always works in favor of collapse. And we saw that we have a line between stability and instability at a virial ratio of about 1. If we take now an isolated isothermal cloud of mass m and radius r, we can write down the kinetic energy just as 3/2 times the cloud mass times the sound speed squared, and the gravitational energy is just minus a times gm squared over r. And here a is a preformed factor that factors in internal density structures. This is a number of order unity, and therefore we ignore it here at the moment. Now our stability or instability condition is that our ratio, our virial ratio, needs to be larger or equal than 1. Putting in the two formulas for T and W, we find that this corresponds to R larger than Gm over Cs squared. Or if we replace the total mass by the mean gas density as mass divided by the R to the third power, ignoring all the constant four factors, then we have a radius criterion of R larger or equal than Cs over square root of G times the density. So this is a quick estimate of the instability. Anything larger than this R is prone to gravitational instability. With this in mind, we can now look at the full analysis presented by Jeans, which goes as follows. Let's consider a uniform infinite isothermal medium at rest. So we have a density, rho naught, a pressure, P naught, that can also be written in terms of the pressure and the sound speed, which is a constant because we are isothermal, and a velocity field V naught equals zero. Now we can write down our HT equations, and the so these are here the continuity equation and the conservation of momentum equation, as we saw previously, and we can write down our Poisson equation to actually compute the gravitational potential here from the density distribution. Now our quantities phi naught, which is the gravitational potential, rho naught, which is the mean density, V naught, the velocity field, and P naught are exact solutions of this system of equations, and the time derivative that is zero because we are in these are the quantity are all constant if we have no perturbations. Now we can write this down, but please be aware that there is no function phi naught such that Nabla squared phi naught is equal to a non-zero constant value in all space, because we cannot have an infinite uniform medium. So this is just an approximation to a finite uniform medium. Now let's introduce a perturbation epsilon that is much smaller than one. So every of our terms is perturbed by a small component. So our total density is now rho naught plus epsilon rho 1. Velocity is epsilon times V1 field, and phi is phi naught plus epsilon phi 1. And now we assume as perturbation a simple single Fourier mode as the perturbation form. So, which means that we write down our perturbation term rho 1 as rho r, the amplitude of the term, times the exponential term here, exp of I kx minus w t. And we will only use the real term here later. And we choose our coordinate system in such that our wave vector k is in the direction of the x direction, which simplifies then here the term. Now we can ask, we can insert the perturbed density into the Poisson equation and figure out what is the resulting potential gravitational potential perturbation. So inserting this here on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side gives us the Poisson equation. And since we have the unperturbed form like this, the left term on either side cancels out, and we are left with Nabla squared of epsilon phi 1 equals 4 pi g epsilon rho 1. We can now insert the definition of rho, and find that the potential perturbation phi 1 can be written in terms of the rho, the perturbed density, times this 4 factor of minus 4 pi g over k squared. So the full form of our gravitational potential is like this, and this prefactor is the amplitude of the perturbed gravitational potential. And now we can use this and insert it into the equation of momentum to figure out what motion this perturbation does induce. Again, we insert all our perturbed terms and replace here the pressure terms in terms of Cs squared and the densities. Then we linearize them, which means we expand in powers of epsilon and drop all terms where we have orders of epsilon squared and higher, because they are very small. So we can write down the equation here, inserting our perturbed term for the density. We can split the time derivative apart, and the right hand divergence simplifies to this term because our unperturbed density is constant. Which will also cancel out this term here on the left hand side. The epsilon cancels out. So we are left here with d rho 1 dt plus divergence of rho naught v 1 equals 0. So this is from the conservation of mass equation. And when we insert into the conservation of momentum equation, we get here this long term. But again, we can remove everything of second order, and we make use of the fact that rho naught and phi naught are constant, so some of the derivatives vanish, which leaves us with the momentum equation here for our perturbations. And again, when we insert now the functional form of the perturbed velocity field, similarly to our perturbed density fields and potential fields, we can write our equation down in terms of these perturbed functions. And if we divide by all the common non-zero terms, we are here left with this expression. So the amplitude of the velocity field perturbation, x equals omega times the pressure amplitude divided by k times the unperturbed density, not pressure, but density amplitude, sorry. And inserting the same into the second equation finally leaves us with this expression, which can be simplified like this, which is the general dispersion relation of our system that describes the dispersion of the plane wave solution and relates spatial frequencies k, wave number k, to the temporal frequencies omega, and tells us how quickly large or small perturbations, spatially large perturbations, disperse in our cloud. So this dispersion relation has, or these results have a couple of implications. Let's first assume that we have perturbations with short wavelength, which means our k is a very large number. So this will probably, this means that the left-hand side of our, the one side of our dispersion relation will be larger than zero. Going back here. So the right-hand side will be larger than zero, which means taking the square root gives us a real number for omega. Inserting this in our functional form for the perturbed density, so we have here a real number, which means given our short wavelengths that we have a uniform background density with small oscillations, small ripples in space and time on top of the uniform background. And since k the magnitude of the whole exponential is smaller than 1 everywhere, this means that these oscillations do not grow. In time. So they remain small. When we look at the opposite case, long wavelengths equaling very small wave numbers, then this term is smaller than zero, which makes omega an imaginary number. And the factor e to the minus e omega t can either decay to zero for the positive root of omega squared, or it can grow to infinity for the negative root of omega squared. Which means that at least one solution of our perturbation will not remain small, it will grow, and this is the definition of an instability. Which means that small perturbations will grow to be large. With this, we can figure out a critical size scale beyond which perturbations must grow to a nonlinear amplitude because they are not anymore stabilized by the pressure. And this is when our omega flips sign. So omega zero is the limiting case between stable and unstable cases, which leaves us with this Jean's criterion for the wave number, and we can convert the wave number to a wavelength, to a spatial length, by dividing 2 pi with the wave number, and this gives us here the Jean's length that separates the stable and the unstable solutions, which is just a function of the sound speed and the mean density in our cloud. Associated to this length scale, we can approximate a mass scale when we just take the volume of lambda to the power of 3 times a density, and this corresponds this size to a mass over which a clump becomes gravitationally unstable. Now to get an idea on what dimensions, on what spatial and physical dimensions this is important, let's look at our typical example, a giant molecular cloud. We have a mean density of, let's say, 100 particles per cubic centimeter. And we have a sound speed on the order of 200 meter per second. This gives us a genes length of 3.4 parsec at a density of 100 particles per cubic centimeter. Is this large or is this small? So every giant molecular cloud is larger than 3 parsec. As a consequence, any perturbation that this giant molecular cloud experiences, so any small deviations, for example, in density from the average density, will grow on scales larger than 3.4 parsecs. And there will always be perturbations. No giant molecular cloud is totally homogeneous. So once our clouds are large enough, it's not possible to build up enough internal gas pressure to prevent collapse. So we will always have, on a scale of lambda that is larger than lambda genes, sub-volumes in our cloud that have a sufficient high mass so that we will start collapses here in subparts of the cloud just because of the instability criterion. We can also look at how fast these perturbations grow. Again, let's take a GMC, assume a size of 50 parsec, which gives us a wave number of 0.12 per parsec. We can then put this in our dispersion relation, taking the negative root here of the growing mode, which gives us this term, and this gives us the E folding time for the disturbance to grow, which is proportional to 1 over square root of G times rho naught. And here introduce the definition of what's called freefall time, that is the characteristic time scale for a medium that has no internal pressure support, and it is the time for all the particles to collapse to the center. And we also note that this is proportional to 1 over square root of G naught, and the factors come from the details of the density distribution and the geometric shape. But we also see that they are of the order of unity. So 3 pi is 12 divided by 30, so that's 1/3. So that's about 1. So this is here the similarity between our rough approximation and the detailed freefall time. And we will now look at possible support of a collapsing core due to magnetic fields, because magnetic terms always oppose collapse, because it would include an increase of the magnetic pressure, which would push the material apart. Let's consider a uniform spherical cloud of radius r that is threaded by a magnetic field B, which is uniform inside the cloud and quickly drops down to a uniform but much smaller field B naught outside of the cloud. Then in the virial theorem, we have the B term here with the TM tensor, and by assumption, the magnetic pressure inside is dominated by the magnetic field inside the cloud, which is here given by B, and the surface magnetic pressure term depends on the magnetic pressure in the environment here, in the regions outside of our cloud. We can look at the magnetic flux that is passing through the cloud, which is just the cross-sectional area P times R squared times B. And since the same magnetic field lines also need to pass through the virial surface that is enclosing our cloud at all times, even if it is collapsing, we can also phi b equal pi b times r naught squared. So for b, we can write down this term in units of the magnetic flux. When we compare this with the gravitational form, a term for a uniform cloud of mass, which is given here, and also depends on 1 over r, we can write down the sum of the two, it should be here a plus sign, as this term, where we introduce m phi squared, which is the magnetic critical mass, which is constant since our magnetic flux phi b is constant because of the flux freezing. So even when we collapse, this remains constant. So by this comparison, by taking the sum between the two, we can now compare which of the two terms is stronger. Is it the gravitational term W, or is it the oppositely acting term, magnetic term B? And since we both relate them to masses, we can now say that if the mass of our clump is larger than the critical magnetic mass, then the gravitational forces are stronger than the magnetic pressure that's acting against collapse, so the magnetic force will be unable to stop the collapse, and our cloud is called magnetically supercritical. If our mass is smaller than the magnetic critical mass, so the sum B plus W is larger than zero, our gravity is weaker than the magnetism, and our cloud is called magnetically subcritical. A magnetically subcritical cloud will never collapse because the magnetic field, the magnetism, will always stabilize it at a finite radius. And the only way for the cloud to further collapse is to reduce the magnetic flux that's threading the cloud, and this is only possible, as we saw in the previous lecture, by, for example, ambipolar diffusion, so a slow diffusion of the neutral against the ionized particles. For real clouds, the critical magnetic mass is estimated as 0.12 times the magnetic flux divided by the square root of g, For an ideal cloud, we find 0.17 instead of 0.12. When we now look at observational results, we find that in general it looks like that magnetic fields in molecular clouds are usually not strong enough to prevent gravitational collapse. This is shown here in this figure, where we show the magnetic field component along the line of sight in microgauss as a function of column density of the cloud. So column density is a measure of the total mass, and the dashed line here separates the supercritical from the subcritical parts, and we see that only for low mass clouds we find magnetically subcritical conditions. So everything below the curve is usually prone to gravitational collapse.